We'll go to the wave equation. Yeah, as I told already, it takes time to get into your mind these any new notion. So if you don't follow, don't worry about it. You just start reading. Yeah, circulating. So don't feel yourself, it's a controllability is a thing which we cannot learn. Don't develop that feeling when you hear a new topic. And you control yourself, she said. Okay. It's possible, you take time. Any new things will take time. Okay. But you can do it. So the wave equation. I hope all of you had a nice course on PDE. Okay. So I'll be taking this. Why? This is in, so if I need a domain omega t. Or q, you call it omega cross 0 to t, that's what you and y at 0 is equal to y naught, y prime at 0 is equal to y1, and y is equal to this is in omega. You need two initial conditions to take care of that, and you need a boundary condition to take care of this operator. So that is, so I'm acting the control on through this. So this is my control now. This is the boundary control problem. Of course, you can do with, if you act it here, it's a distributional control. So you have a domain omega. You can act here, or you can also possible to act in small part of it. Or you have a domain gamma, which is the boundary of omega. And then, so this will be here. So I'm just describing one problem. So you have analogous things, you can work it out. Sigma is equal to gamma cross 0 to t. So that's the way you have to understand this. So yxt has the boundary value. This is a standard value problem, PDE problem. So if you have not seen that PDE, of course I can't do anything here. Okay. So I assume that this is the same equation you study, the wave equation. If you take d square by dx square, y by dx square, you have your one-dimensional wave equation. And then you have your, that definitely you would have solved in your studies, right? That's what your first thing you study, variable separable form, all that. So I have kept the Laplacian here. So what is the control problem I am looking at it? So this is a controlled system, you see? Is a control system. So what's the control problem? Given y naught, y1. You have, there are many difficulties, many issues, control problem. And there are more serious troubles also. I'm not setting here, but one standard setting is, it is in H, and yt naught, yt1. One standard setting of the for the existence of solutions. I'm assuming that right now. But then you have to study the system and existence in a weaker space. That's why the control problem will lead to the normal method of, because the data will be in a much weaker space. You'll see that. But the standard space is this one, H1 naught cross L2. So we'll start with that. Let's see. So does there exist U? This is also a question, U, but I am taking L2 of sigma, that's a problem will come existence, we'll discuss that. So don't worry about the regularity property. Normally this is not enough for a standard formulation, because you need, when for each t, you need some sort of, with respect to the spatial variable, you need some sort of h half. But then a reasonable control which you will be getting in L2, not that kind of regular controls all the time. Depending on the space of thing. Here also we are going to have a larger space. So you will have all types of controllability. It need not be. So the space of controllable space is this one. And this is the initial and final point line. Later, but when you describe the method, you will see this is more dual of that. It will be. You will be studying with L2 cross H minus 1. So you will be doing the control system with L2 cross H minus 1. But then you have that kind of weak data, the existence will be in question, and that we will see. You need to study that in a much weaker form, not the standard form. So the You can simply formulate right now. Does there exist? Because anyway, I'm not answering immediately, right? So does the asking any question is okay. So does there exist U in L2 of omega such that Y at T is equal to Y T naught and Y prime at T is equal to Y T1. Okay. Because you have to stabilize not only the Y, you also have to stabilize its derivative. That's important for the wave equation. One of the model is the vibration model, right? So when you have suppose something is vibrating, two-dimensional domain is vibrating, you want to stop the vibration. That's a null controllability. Okay, how do you stop? So you are just stopping y equal to 0 is not enough. You also have to have the kind of tangential vibrations and all that. So how to stop the complete vibration just to y equal to 0, as well as you need y prime equal to 0. Okay, so when this is reaching to 0, it is called an null controllability. As you see that earlier system, you can prove for this system the null controllability and the general controllability are the same. So you can, without loss of generality, you can start with 0 here, 0 here, which you can do that. First you construct solutions with satisfying the algebraic constraint, and then exactly the similar way you can prove it. So that's a generally a controllability question suitable to this one. Space setting is all right, but the general controllability you can write like that. So starting, so the initial point is this one. From the initial point, can you reach your at time t to the desired state which you are given a priori? Or can you drive the system from the point y naught, y1 to the origin or to the point yt? So you are trying to do this instead of Rn. This is the space now, which you have seen, the Sobolev space which you have seen. So that's the Sobolev space we are looking at it. Okay, that's the point. So you have this, if you reach this one, it's called controllability. If you are able to reach only to the zero, then it is called a null controllability. So, but then for nonlinear systems, especially when you study Navier-Stokes equations, which is nonlinear, so asking a general controllability is a difficult thing. And then people study the null controllability. And also for parabolic equations, there are reasons, but everything I will not be able to tell. But parabolic equation, a suitable notion is approximate controllability. Exact controllability is not the right one. Approximate controllability. So you can also introduce a notion, approximate controllability. It basically tells you that you vary u along the certain space here, look for all solutions and collect all the sets yt and y prime of t. Here what you are asking is that whether that reachable set, so there is a notion called a reachable set, right? It's basically the set of all four elements of the form yt, y prime of t. This is your reachable set. This is your reachable set. And what you are asking in the controllability is that whether this reachable set is this set. Then you say that it is controllable. But you don't get it, that one. So the reasonable question in parabolic equation, especially heat equation, etc., is the reachable set dense in that space? Is dense? Is R dense? Dense in the space of controllable space. That's a notion of approximate controllability. This is due to the effect of the smoothing effect of the parabolic equations, because parabolic equation smoothens the data. So you cannot expect something to reach exactly, but you can only approximate. But in finite dimensional system, you don't see, because the finite dimensional system, this is Rn. You see, this is Rn, the Euclidean space. And the reachable set has the property of the convexity. And Rn doesn't have any convex set which is dense. In Rn, the only convex set which is dense is Rn itself. So approximate controllability notion is the same as the exact controllability in the finite dimension. So you don't have to worry about that. You see the difficulties slightly cropping up when you get into the system. Okay. So what I want to give you the first, initially, I want to give you a motivation. Anyway, I will not have time to prove any much thing, but I want to see the motivate some system via an optimal control problem. So suppose you have your UAD is the possible admissible controls. So our aim is definitely to show that UAD is not empty, right? This is what we are trying to prove it. We want to prove that there is a control. We prove that controllability, system is controllability. But then normally mathematicians are always greedy, right? The moment you write a theorem, you want to write a corollary all the time, right? And you want to prove more theorems. So if you look at UAD, if you are anyway, you are going to prove that if at all possible, if at all you are able to prove some result, you are going to prove that UAD is non-empty. Then why not give the best to the engineers? Choose the best one according to some criteria. Okay. So you want to do, if UAD is non-empty, I want to pick up the best one. Best one according to certain criteria. So I want to possibly select, minimize certain criteria with respect to, say, L2 norm. So among all controls, I want to select V is equal to UAD. Okay. So I want to solve this problem, assuming that what further information, if UAD is non-empty, whether I can get something and I can derive some nice equations based on that. So here I'm going to use to solve that problem what is called the method of penalization. So what are we trying to do? We want so many things to happen. You want the differential constraint to be satisfied. You have two algebraic constraints. Together with you have two more algebraic constraints. That's additional. This is just PDE. For every U, you have this one. But the idea is to, if U is from UAD, or if there is a control, you want to choose U in such a way that this is also satisfied. But then one thing is easy. If you don't demand your algebraic thing, if you do not demand the differential constraint to be satisfied, suppose I need only to satisfy my algebraic constraint, just like in finite dimension, you have plenty of choices. That's not a problem. So you can immediately construct a set, this set. So you want choose set, so this is my class of functions now I'm choosing. I want this constraint to be satisfied on the boundary, which you can do it. And then I want z at 0 is equal to y naught. Z prime at 0 is equal to y1. I want this final time also to be satisfied. y0 at t. And z prime at t is equal to yt1. Assume that one. Anyway, we are going to derive something like that. And then I am not demanding this to be 0. If I know that there is a V satisfying all that, everything is fine. But I don't demand my differential constraint to satisfy. I just say that this is something like LQ of omega t function. That's all. So that's a problem of looking for the algebraic constraint. Okay. So what I want is that I want to find a V if possible so that this is equal to 0. Since this we do not have any information, it is something like constraint. I put it with my cost function I, and I penalize my cost with that one. So I construct a new cost functional, J of VZ is equal to integral of V square. Maybe I'll put U half, and I put this epsilon is needed. This is what is called a penalization. I'll put z prime minus Laplacian of z equal to 0. Square is equal to 0. You see? And I want to study this. And this is intuitive why this penalization works. Once you have the minimum problem, you expect this whole thing to behave nicely. That means this quantity will eventually will behave like an order. Since there is an epsilon here in the denominator, if we tell this one to behave nicely, this will be of order of epsilon. So when epsilon becomes smaller and smaller, this will eventually go to zero. And getting at the limit, I'll be getting back my z prime minus Laplacian of z equal to zero. Okay? So you want to minimize this function, v epsilon z epsilon is equal to minimize jvz. Then you have to prove something, which is standard. This is a very nice regularized problem. There is no problem for anything. You can do everything formally. You want to do. Eventually, I will give the Hilbert uniqueness method, but you can do everything here. So, what are the things which PDE people normally do? The moment you have, our life is based on estimates, nothing else, right? You want to get the right estimates. If you have the right estimate, you have it.
The problem is that you will not be able to get it easily. So eventually,
you have to get the right estimates, and including this is something like order of epsilon or something, okay? And then pass to the limit, and then get the solution finally. This is what the thing, right? So let's see, if you proceed this way, what are we going to get it? So if you proceed that way, now you have a nice minimization problem in PDE setup. So it's a, so far we have, whatever we have done is in the ODE setup. Now this is everything is going to be in the PDE setup. But in the PDE which you probably have to study, I don't know anybody will cover here, you can write down the optimality system using the constant PDE. That's the beauty of it. You can probably get into that. For elliptic, hyperbolic and parabolic, all that thing, you will be able to write down an optimality system introducing the concept of a costate. Yesterday what we have seen it, you have introduced your state and you also have introduced the costate. So you can write down, the way approach is the same, but you have to be very cleverly pass through it. But either you vary this one and proceed. Epsilon, don't think, when you do that, you don't think epsilon is a fixed parameter. So this is just a fixed problem. With respect to epsilon, don't take this for varying and you study this one. So you vary this one and write down the minimization problem, introduce appropriate cost functional, satisfied by certain PDE, and then you can write down your optimal. So if this solution, the minimizer, will satisfy the optimality system. I'll just write down the optimality system. The optimality system will be, you have a, let me write g because there is an epsilon, minus Laplacian of y epsilon. This will not satisfy zero because we are not minimizing with that constraint. We have not taken any algebraic constraint. You will get only this is equal, this is in L2. Okay. Q is omega t. And the conditions is that, you have y epsilon equal to u epsilon. This you have it. And you have y epsilon 0 is equal to y naught. Y epsilon prime of 0 is equal to y1. And you also have the boundary condition, the terminal condition. That's what we have seen, right? So the whole thing is this one. So we have incorporated the terminal condition which we require, but not the differential constraint. So we have this one. This is for about y epsilon, which is part of the solution. There is nothing new about it. The thing is that about the adjoint state, you will also, in the optimality system, you will also have an adjoint state p epsilon. What are the p epsilons will satisfy? P epsilons will satisfy ptt of epsilon
minus
Laplacian of p epsilon. This you will get. You will get a PDE and you get P epsilon equal to 0 on sigma, and dP epsilon by d nu is equal to u epsilon. You can derive all this. Don't need anything. You write down the controllability is not coming. It's writing down the optimality system. It involves some work, but you can know. How, when you have a minimization problem, how to derive an optimality system by the deviation of parameter. It involves quite a bit of work, but you have to do it, and you can do it. The difficult part is has not yet come. What do we do? This is a standard procedure. And you have one more information you can derive, which is very crucial. You get P epsilon equal to, you get an information about this in terms of your P epsilon. And it will be minus 1 over epsilon P YTT of epsilon minus Laplacian of Y epsilon. To introduce Hilbert uniqueness method, you don't need all this, okay? This is the kind of thing why we introduce that. This is a one way of motivation which I feel is more comfortable. There may be other types of motivations one can get it. Okay. So the question is that of, so if you have, you will have the correct estimate, you will be able to pass to the limit, and what you get it if you, that information. So whenever you have an optimal control problem, that's a big issue, another thing. A lot of problems which, not in this context. There will be minimization problems, optimal problem, parameterized by small parameters. And the thing is that you want to study that optimal control problems. The first step in studying such control problem is the optimality system. Write down the optimality system and pass to the limit in the optimality system. That's an easy part. The difficult part is that the limit, why should the limit should be actually a minimization problem? This is in general. Okay. So you can pass to the limit. When you pass to the limit, you get this equation. That you will be, now you are bringing back your equation. You get that. This is in omega t. You will also get y equal to u on sigma. But I have not characterized y. So you have not solved much. Okay. Y prime of t is equal to 0. Y at 0 is equal to y naught. Y prime at 0 is equal to 0. This is about y. PTT minus Laplacian P is equal to 0. The equation. You will get P equal to 0 on sigma. And you have a third information. U is equal to dP by dV. You see? You may have a sudden impression that we solved our problem. But there is a one serious missing guy to complete the problem. Can you see that? Of course, this looks like an overdetermined system right now. But you see, there is no initial conditions we could capture. So the problem is not set up. You don't have an initial condition. So what are the initial conditions? How do you set up that? What is the initial condition? Initial condition for P. So if you can get your initial condition for your co-state, you are done basically. Okay. That is the information. But that is okay. So that's a question which we do not know. But the interesting point, it looks like that. Your control looks like this. Whatever. It's our, something existing. But you are not able to prescribe your initial condition. But the one possibility is that there is the control must look like this form. This is a possible way of searching your control. It comes from the normal derivative of some adjoint state equation. So if we can give a correct, if we can prove the existence of correct initial condition for this system, then you will also get your control. And so that's why this is basically a constructive method. Even you can derive, developing numerical schemes for this method is available. Okay, and that's the feature of Hilbert uniqueness method I am going to now present. Then you will see that this method is a little more general. So, Hilbert uniqueness method. No, that eventually it reduces to the PDE analysis. That's where you can use the rich theory of PDE. You see, that's the kind of, that's the importance of here. Your all minimization problem, everything is vanished at the end of it. It reduces to this kind of a coupled system of optimality conditions. Okay? So let me start with So we'll start with phi naught phi 1. I have to set up even the space properly. When you go the difficulty, you will see. So I will start with which is the most comfortable thing. I start with an initial condition here. That's what you expect, right? You do not know what it is. You start with an initial. So I will change a little bit of notation. And introduce this problem. Phi tt minus Laplacian of phi equal to 0. Phi equal to 0 on d omega. Sigma. And phi h 0 is equal to phi naught. Phi prime 0 is equal to phi naught. Then if I, how to choose is what the issue. But then I know that d phi by d nu is the one giving me a control. So I will introduce a problem. Psi t t minus Laplacian psi is equal to 0. And I want this to be satisfied. Because I want to choose eventually, so I don't want to fix this now, phi 1. Because I don't know what, for what phi naught and phi 1, or we do not know there will be phi naught and phi 1 for which this will be getting it. But I am certainly sure that I want this. So I put that condition at psi t is equal to 0, equal to psi prime of t, and I want to act on psi my d phi by d nu. This is what I want to act. So the question, the controllability problem in this,
even if you don't follow anything here,
I can just start my Hilbert uniqueness method here. You start with your phi naught phi 1, satisfying this condition. And with the phi, I have my d phi by d nu, introduce this problem.
Okay.
Forget about, don't read all that. Okay. You just look at two these equations. The moment I am able to choose my phi naught and phi 1 in such a way that this solution also satisfies this boundary condition,
my exact controllability problem is solved.
So the exact controllability is solved if we can choose phi naught phi 1, whichever space it is, such that psi satisfies phi at 0 is equal to y naught and psi prime at 0 is equal to y1. That's it. You can, so you reformulated your exact controllability problem in terms of an adjoint equations. So I want to associate a mapping. So I will introduce a mapping lambda, probably from the right space. Space we will see.
Soon we will see.
So basically I want to have a mapping which phi naught phi 1 going to my psi 0. I'll put the signs correctly later because I want that
dual mapping.
I want to understand this mapping.
That's my issue.
From here, I want to understand this mapping. So, if I am looking for my controllability in a certain space, say some x cross y,
what I want?
I want my phi naught phi 1 to be in such a way that psi 0 is equal to psi prime of 0 is equal to y1. So, if I have the right spaces here and here, and if I see that this mapping is onto, then I have my controllability problem is again solved.
Because
if this mapping is onto, then whichever space it is, every point has a phi naught phi 1 here, so that I have achieved that, my y1. For every y naught y 1, whichever space you are lying y naught y 1. So if you have a space here where y naught y 1 lies and this mapping is onto, that y naught y 1 will have a phi naught phi 1. Choose that phi naught phi 1, solve this one, and you not only solve, get your controllability problem solved, and you also know how the control looks like. This is the kind of normal that we think.
Why did you choose
No, that is motivated the equation here. This limit equation is phi 0. See, how does the control look like? Control look like a dp by d nu, right? With p equal to 0 on the boundary. So that's what I looked at. So this I replaced by p. P satisfies this equation, P satisfies this boundary condition, And we do not know anything about the boundaries and initial conditions. So it's coming from that. Alright? So that we have to basically prove that lambda is an onto or isomorphism. We can prove that onto isomorphism, you are done. Okay. So we need appropriate spaces to define. So I want to point out a few difficulties. Initially, the two inequality difficulties which you want to do it, and that gives you your observability estimate. Overcoming that difficulty is one is the observability estimate. One I want to, this is fine. What about the existence of the solution, right? Let me write it this one. Two, regarding one, P exists, right? It's a nice space. There is no problem. If P naught, P1 satisfies in H1 naught plus L2 omega, then P exists nicely. Where does it exist? P is in C of 0 to T. I hope this kind of spaces get familiarized quickly. You will see maybe more this type of spaces. So far you have seen in the these lectures only this type of thing. So start seeing this parabolic hyperbolic equation, you need this because there is a time variable. Intersection C1 of 0 to T L2. Okay. And you have a finite energy solution. So you have an energy, that's what it is. It's a finite energy solution. That is half of integral of grad phi t square plus p prime of t square. This is, you can prove all this. In fact, it is conserved. E t is equal to E0. That's equal to half of integral of grad phi naught square plus integral of E1 square. So you have a finite energy there. So you want to have two difficulties which you face it immediately, which is not given by the PDE analysis. The first difficulty is the interpretation. Okay, yes, fine, they may do it. Because if everything is nice, everything is nice. No problem. The thing is interpretation of d phi by d nu. Restricted to the boundary, right? This is not interpreted because when you have, I don't know, you didn't cover trace or anything, right?
No, trace is not covered.
Good. That's a good motivation to study whatever he introduced and continuation of the trace theory and all that. He is concentrated only on embedding, right? So there is another part. Trace to interpret your PDE and everything. The thing is that this is something like grad phi dot nu. Okay, so the grad phi is an L2 function. Phi is in H1, so the grad phi is only an L2 function in omega. Grad phi is only an L2 function. But then, once you have the moment, the trace is not well defined. There is no meaning how to interpret. I don't want to say anything because that itself needs some hours.
The trace theory
of the Sobolev spaces. Because you need that something to be like an L2, right? At least L2, you see. So you understand now why control cannot be expected very regular easily. Even getting an L2, is a difficult issue. Okay. So to do that one, if you want to have a meaning to this one, one thing is appeal to the regularity theory if there is. That means whether you can interpret phi is in H2. But that's not in general true. There is no H2 regularity. But this is what, luckily for this problem, there is something what is called a hidden regularity. So of course this can be interpreted as an L2 function if you have phi in H2. Without being that, you can have a hidden regularity. That's a new thing which one has to prove. It may not be new, but what I'm saying that it is not given directly from the regularity theory, because you don't have the regularity of H2 in general. If you have it, no problem. You are done. So that's first theorem has to prove. I'm not even going to say anything about that one, but because this may require at least 10 hours to prove it.
Because a lot of...
It's not that difficult as you said yesterday. It's a basic integration by parts. Just functions. But then it runs so many terms. So the thing is that norm of d nu by d phi in L2 of sigma is less than or equal to a constant which depends on t into E naught. This one. In H1 or H1. You can prove it. So you have a d phi b, d nu b actually is directly proved. This is based on, the proof is based on called what are called multiplier techniques in PDE. That's what I said, the PDE thing still can be used. It's called the multiplier techniques. Okay. And basically you have to use multipliers of this form and integrate by parts and write down. This is the relic prosho type. Poso. 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 Really, Poso. It's used elsewhere also. Poseo or Poso?
First used.
So you have to use this one, play with this equation, and you can prove. So this is a purely PDE thing. Okay, a direct proof of that. You have to multiply and go do the analysis, and you can do that. The difficulty two. The second difficulty, so you have the nice theorem. First difficulty is overcome with a hard work. D nu by D, D nu of V only in L2 of sigma. That's what it. But then, to have this one again because of the trace, when you have a solution to this problem, you need some sort of h half with respect to the spatial variable. You need h half regularity to interpret in the standard form. So the standard way of interpreting the solution is not possible here. You have to go to one more level of integration by parts, and this method is called. So you have to interpret psi in a weak sense. In a weaker sense, you are already everything interpreting in a weak sense. You have to interpret in a weak sense. So this is done by the method of transposition. It's not very thing, it's actually much more easier to prove it, if you understand. And earlier you are doing an integration by parts one, but that doesn't have meaning. You do an integration by parts once more to get an adjoint equation. So let me, because even if you don't learn control theory, learn PDE, so you can work in other areas also. So I will give that part. So I will just explain what is quickly. What is, then it is a representation theorem. What do you do is that just integrate by parts. This equation doesn't have meaning. Normally, you integrate once by parts. You do an integration by parts twice. Then you will be able to do that one. So what do you do with that? So the method of transposition I want to tell you. So start with the f in L1 of 0 to t, L2 of omega. Theta naught is in H1 naught of omega. Theta 1 in L2 of omega. Okay, that's very nice thing. Nice class. Define theta in the same class. It's okay, C of 0 to T. This is standard because you have theta not correctly, theta 1 correctly for the boundary value problem. This is on the right hand side, and that's the correct one. So as long as you have the correct one, no problem. H1 naught, intersection C1 of 0 to T L2, such that theta double prime minus Laplacian of theta is equal to F, theta 0 is equal to theta naught, theta prime 0 is equal to theta 1, and theta is equal to 0 on the boundary. This is a well-defined classical problem, okay, because you have the right spaces. Theta naught, you have the right space, theta 1 has. This is a standard way of deriving more and more weaker form, right? You always do it that way. Now, what do you do is that you multiply this function by theta, this equation by theta, multiply this equation by xi, integrate by parts, then you know that all the terms coming, the omega terms coming from will get cancelled, because when you integrate twice, you get the things are getting cancelled, except the boundary terms and the homogeneous term. The rest will get cancelled because it's the same operator. For example, if you integrate, you get grad psi, grad theta. Here you will get grad theta, grad psi. Similarly, here theta prime, psi prime. Here you will get xi t, theta t. Everything will get cancelled except the boundary terms are coming. So this will imply a formulation of this form, integral of f psi plus theta naught psi prime of 0 plus theta 1 psi 0 equal to minus integral of d nu of theta d nu of psi. Now you see the only trouble term was this one, and this is now well defined because of this inequality. Because of what I have written here, the hidden inequality is the PDE inequality. Hence, this is also true for xi, is also true for theta. That hidden inequality is available both for c and both for t. So both of these terms are L2 functions. Hence, this is an L1 function. It's well defined. Okay. Now you just approach. That's an exercise I will leave to you. Even if you don't know any PDE, it's okay. That exercise can be done. Okay.
Theorem is only for the PDE.
Yeah, I think it's a for the PDE. Yeah. I don't know other things. I don't know. But this is for the wave equation. I don't know for heat equation this multiplier technique will work, because there is no reversibility and all that. I don't know. So you can associate a linear functional with this and apply just race representation theorem
to prove the existence of that.
So a solution psi is called a transposition solution. So let me write down a definition. Psi is called as transposition solution. If the star holds for all f theta naught theta 1. So that's called. So that existence can be quickly proved using race representation theorem. Since you are applying race representation theorem, f is in this space, you are going to get the solution in the dual. Okay, so it will be an infinity. So you get theorem E, there exists xi, satisfying, belongs to, let me write the correct space if I have it. Yeah, so you have the correct space xi is in, C is C of 0 to t. So you see the spaces are changed now. So the solution will be in L2. So you are basically interpreting solution special variable only with respect to L2. Okay, that's all the best you can do. C1, 0 to t, and it will be into the next lower space, h minus of omega. So the earlier phi solution was here. You see h1 naught, and you have the L2. So with that, the two difficulties what I mentioned is fine. So both inequalities, so both the difficulties you are can overcome with that transposition method. And what you have to take the message is that to the control, you cannot expect to have more regularity in general to do that. You do get control, more generality if you don't want. Another thing which you will be getting here Since psi is in this space, psi at 0 will be L2 and psi prime 0 will be h minus 1. And that is what you are expecting to be y0 and y1. So your controllability space, though we initially started with h1 naught h1, the controllability what you are going to achieve now is a much bigger space, not in a smaller space. You are going to get your controllability in a much bigger space, like a
L2
cross h minus 1. Of course, you can get much bigger space, but the controls will be weaker. And if you, you want only controllability in a smaller space, you can have smoother control. So the regularity of the control will change in depending on which space you are looking at the controllability. So this is a representation theorem. We'll follow. So that gives you my correct space setting for the time being. So I can set up. I don't think I will be able to make more remarks, but because that's the, due to the time, but you can read it. So my lambda mapping is now H1 naught cross L2 to L2 cross H minus 1. I define lambda of phi naught phi 1. I have written that way. That's a way I write, because if I think this as my F, I want that order correctly. In principle, it doesn't matter whether you change it or not, but I take it in a, this notation, this is the right way of writing it. Phi 1, I will write down, it is psi 0. That doesn't matter, I will put a minus sign here because I want to get it the right note. And what you can prove, this is a bit of an algebra. You don't need any serious thing, which you can do it. Those who do not even know the PDE can do it. But you can compute this. Your issue is to complete this. You have to prove this. If I can prove this lambda is an onto isomorphism, then I know that there is a controllability in this bigger space with my controls are giving in this form as an L2 control. So I will achieve if I prove the lambda controllability, if I prove the lambda isomorphism in this space, and you have the control. But that's not true all the time, right? Phi naught phi 1, this is equal to, let me write it, it's exactly norm of d phi by d nu. See, this is what your observation now, L2 of sigma square. Okay. So what is the regular, thing? What it proves is that what you have given is that lambda is continuous, right? Where did you get this from? This is from my hidden regularity, right? That's nothing but your hidden regularity we proved. Because if you want to prove that lambda is continuous, you want to prove that one, and you will get, you will have that. If you write your thing. So what we need to prove it is a non-to isomorphism, we need a reverse inequality. That's the whole issue. We need a reverse inequality. If the moment you prove this reverse inequality, you have your isomorphism. Okay, what is the reverse inequality I want? Norm of phi naught phi 1. This is standard function analysis, right? You can think it as some appropriate Hilbert space. You can do that one. So you have a different norm, basically. Okay.
So with respect to,
and what I'm trying to do is that the new norm which I have got it is equivalent to the norm here. And the fundamental difficulty in the controllability problem is that you can always prove controllability some spaces somehow, but you will not be able to identify that to the correct space. So you have the square, this is H1 naught cross L2 is less than or equal to constant into norm of integral of sigma d nu of phi. This is your B star of phi coming here if you look at your matrix T. Okay. That's a way. So there is no B in reduction. So you want to, you need a reverse inequality. the reverse inequality is not true in general. So this whole thing tells that the moment you have a reverse inequality, lambda is an isomorphism. So you take any y naught to y1 here, it's an onto map. So if you take any y naught to y1 here, you solve this problem lambda of y naught y1 is equal to y naught minus y1, and take that phi naught phi1. The moment you take phi naught phi1, you solve this problem to get phi, apply d phi by d nu here, solve for psi, it will give you the solution. So psi will give you the solution, and d phi by d nu will give you the control. So the controllability problem is solved the moment you solve this inequality. And this is what is called the, what is that? This is what is called the observability inequality. So the question eventually reduces to proving an observability inequality for your uncontrolled problem. You can forget everything. You take this problem, forget it. The other one gives you an iterative procedure how to do it. All controllability problem you leave, all the analysis you leave. Start with phi naught phi 1, start with this phi, prove that. And that involves only that, nothing else. And the moment you prove that one, so this is equivalent to you have an observable system. You have a system which is called the observable system. For that observable system, you are observing this one. That's observable. And this inequality is in general not true. Okay. But what it says that in this particular case, but in general, here we have taken the full sigma. So for this is will not be true for if you have a small t, t is small. So the what is theorem tells that if there exists t naught positive such that inequality is true, quality is true, you can prove that for t bigger than t, there exists inequality true for t greater than t naught. That's what you can prove. So if you have the of the control problem and if you are taking your control all over the boundary, then you have the controllability if t is sufficiently large. In fact, what you get is that you get a term something like this. There exists a t such that this inequality is true. So you will get back your inequality. That's what you will be proving. So I want to make, can I spend 5 minutes, 3 minutes? Okay. If they are tired, if there are quite a few comments, I would have liked to make it. I don't know, maybe quickly. One thing, as I said, thing, you can, you don't need to apply control everywhere. Suppose you have a domain ever and you have a gamma. I divide it into gamma naught. So it's not necessary that you have to apply control everywhere, and that may not be a reasonably good thing. So the idea is that whether can you apply in control in an arbitrary small gamma naught. In general, that is not true. So that's what I said. I think there is a paper due to Bardos, Lebo, and Roche. It gives you some sort of necessary and sufficient condition, but it's a deeper and hard paper. But geometrically what it says that, that's a, geometrically what it says that the gamma naught should be like that, and if you start with any ray here, geometry, and then it will get reflected at the boundary, right? And then it will go on reflecting. So if you want to have your controllability, any ray initiates from anywhere should eventually touch, not eventually, it should meet the control part before time t. So if you see that any ray meets here, time, then you will get the controllability, you can take it. For example, if you have a circle, and if I, suppose it's a center part, so if I apply however close here, and if I take my gamma naught here, and if I take a ray here along the diameter, it will get reflected back here. You see? So you will only get trapped rays here. These are called trapped rays. See, there are some trapped rays which does not meet the control region. That points it does not carry the information from the control, and you will not get controllability. There is an another controllability result, sufficient condition. That's not necessary and sufficient condition, but it is a sufficient condition given probably, I think, J. Lyons. Yeah, it's a wave equation. We don't want for that one. So the thing is that you start any point x naught. You take any point x naught in Rn, doesn't matter. Look at this line, x minus x naught. And I define my gamma naught is equal to set of all x in gamma, first that mx nu x greater than or equal to 0. Nu is the normal there, normal. And then it also gives you the time, which time you can really achieve the controllability. It gives you a measurement. And the measurement is that you have the R naught you define to be maximum of mx, x is in the omega, and your T naught will be 2 R naught. So with this, and you don't need to require the proof. All this proof, when you do this one, be careful, a little more careful, that eventually you can prove this inequality. The terms in sigma, it will contribute sigma naught and sigma 1. You can say that sigma naught 1 can be ignored with that condition, because that will be something like negative contribution, so it doesn't matter. So you get the same analysis, so you don't need to require a different proof. Instead of work sigma, you work with the sigma naught and proceed, use these conditions. Geometrically, it has a nice thing. There are some interesting thing. Suppose you have a circle. And if I take my x naught here, if I take my x naught here, my gamma naught is gamma itself. You can see that one. Okay, because that's a condition here. Because if I take my x naught here, that's a thing. You, every point you need it. But then what is my r naught? R naught is nothing but my its radius. And T naught is the diameter. So that that actually tells you your speed of propagation of the characteristics. You need something to go from here. The time required to reach, if at all there, is your diameter time. You need that much time to reach there. So otherwise the information won't reach there. Okay. On the other hand, instead of x naught, if I so if you choose my x naught here, I can have the controllability in time of the diameter of this circle. But I have to act on the event. But if I take an x naught here, this x naught gives you a benefit, because certainly if I then what would be my gamma naught? You draw the tangent here, and my gamma naught will be this portion. Okay. So this is a very, so you have to, so if x naught is outside T naught, outside the circle, my T naught will be corresponding to this T naught will be greater than the diameter. So you need more time to control the system. But then this is what the flip. Here you don't have to act anywhere. You have to act only in this portion. So it has both advantages. And this is nice thing, if you interpret this as an observer and you have a region you want to control it, circle, and this is exactly the portion, this maximum will be the circle, half of the thing. Okay, whichever be the point, at least half, it will be more than half. You can see that. So you need that condition, because there's nothing contradicts about the Bardo's paper. And it also tells you that the more and more you go, you have to act less and less, and you have to have more and more time. And the other physical view is that you are acting on the part of the boundary which you cannot see. So that's what you have to bother more, right? You have to be careful with your students who don't come to the class. When they come to the class, it's well, because you are watching them. So you have to be act on the portion of the boundary which you cannot do that. I will not continue more. Two small sections which I want to convey to you, that this is much more general. You don't have to take the control. So we have taken the control from your space, sigma. You can take any Hilbert space. You can work with this G. You can follow the same procedure. And then what you have to do is that with respect to that procedure, it gives you something like this. Instead of this one, it will give you something like dP by d nu over G. You get that one. Okay? And then you look at your completion with respect to this norm of d omega cross d omega. You look at the completion of this space. Instead of L2 of omega, you can work any Hilbert space and you can measure your control in that Hilbert space. And according to that thing, you complete this space, you may get a space gamma g. Okay? And then you can set up an isomorphism between gamma g and gamma g prime with the controls in g prime. All that, when you put it inside, you have to change a bit because g is a mapping from. And what we have, so you may think that, so I have a controllability in the space Fg prime with controls in G prime. The moment I have this. So you have the controllability. But what are we so much discussing, so much difficulty, and why we are so much bothered about this one? This tells you that if G is L2 of omega, L2 of sigma, then your gamma G, Fg, is nothing but H1 naught cross L2. The proof of that is what the inequality. So the observability inequality and the hidden inequality is the equivalence of this norm in this space. So the question of in any controllability problem, you can always set up suitably. The problem is the identification of Fg and Fg prime. If you can identify, you are through. You will get correspondingly. And you can proceed further on this one and a little bit of generalization from suitably choosing your H, G, and you can also act a linear operator on that. You can do further. Suppose there is a linear operator acting at G to G. You see? And then you can get the controls here. You see? On this space. Again. So you can generalize that one acting on the linear thing. And if you have a unique continuation principle, so your linear operator satisfies a unique continuation principle, it gives you a new uniqueness theorem. The new uniqueness theorem will tell you that this will be a new norm there. And then you can get the same setup instead of G, you can set up this function. And you can choose some particular nice operators like d by dt, etc., to get the controllability in a bigger space. With the controls in big, you can also do the other way, get the control back. And finally, all this can be generalized to more general operators, Portola system, Petrovsky system, and 2n dimensional, that kind of equation, U triple prime is of A of U, where E is a elliptic operator of order 2n. You can adopt these methods.
Non-linear systems,
I don't know anything. So, I will complete my lectures. Thank you very much. Thanks to all of you. It was very quick. But that's the way conference talks we always give.